Let's welcome our next speaker, Vindhya Prakash from ICFO in Barcelona. Hi, Vindhya.
Hi, Carmen.
Hi. Talking about fungal mandel interference between distinguishable photons. Really looking forward to the talk. Thanks.
Thank you, Carmen. It's an absolute pleasure participating in BQA 21. Thank you very much for the invitation and congratulations for having moved it very seamlessly and efficiently to the virtual platform both last year and this year. So let me get started. Do you think a Hongo-Mandel type of interference is possible between distinguishable photons? And let me get into answering that first by recapping the Hongo-Mandel experiment, though everybody here probably already knows it. So in the Hongo-Mandel original experiment, what was done was two photons that are indistinguishable were brought in two input ports of a beam splitter. And we checked for coincidences at the two output ports, between the two output ports. And these photons can take four possible paths. They can both be reflected, one of them both transmitted, the first reflected, the second transmitted, or the first transmitted and the second reflected. And if these photons are arriving at the same time at the beam splitter, then the first two possibilities are basically indistinguishable from each other, and their probability amplitudes destructively interferes. So that was shown by Hongo and Mandel way back in 1987. And you can see that there's a dip here for the coincidences between these two detectors at zero delay time. However, what happens when these photons are distinguishable, as I've shown here with different colors? Again, the four possibilities after the beam splitter still holds. However, each possibility is clearly distinct from the other. So they do not destructively interfere, even if the photons arrive at the same time. And there is some probability of seeing coincidences, and that is half the total probability, or half of all the four possibilities. So, but what exactly is happening in the case of distinguishable photons? Let's just like take a minute to look at that. Typically, these experiments have been performed in the past with photons that are very broadband. They have hundreds of gigahertz or terahertz in bandwidth. This means they have a coherence time that is in the order of a picosecond to tens of picoseconds. And the detectors that are used to measure these photons have about a nanosecond or at most hundreds of picoseconds in time resolution. So this means just the act of detecting a photon automatically averages over the entire wave packet. And as is with most things in nature, if we are in a hurry, we miss the details. And here, the detectors are in a hurry because they basically detect the entire wave packet in one shot. What if instead of time averaging, we zoomed in and had the time resolution to look inside what happens within the coherence time of these photons? We can see that there are some combinations of detector times for which there is a Hongo-Mandel type of complete destructive interference. However, there are some other combinations of times where there is the opposite of that happening. And again, Hongo-Mandel can happen at some other combinations of times. Let me explain this more concretely. So let us consider the situation. We have a beam splitter 50-50, and we have a low energy photon entering in one phase, a high energy photon entering in the other phase. And we look for coincidences between these two detectors. They can resolve within the coherence time of these wave packets. And we're looking for one click at T in this detector and another click at T prime at this detector. What can cause this kind of a coincidence? Either we can have the high energy photon reflected and detected first at T, and then the low energy photon reflected and detected at T prime. Or we could have the low energy photon transmitted and detected first at T and the high energy transmitted and detected at T prime. Now, since the detectors cannot resolve the frequencies of the photons, the amplitudes for both these processes have to be added. And when we just work out the math a little bit, we can see that there is an oscillation in the coincidences seen between these two detectors. Sometimes it goes all the way down to zero, and we can have a complete Hongo-Mandel type of interference with complete visibility. But this basically oscillates. And the oscillation is at a periodicity that corresponds to the frequency difference between these two photons. So this is very interesting. But what happens at those combinations of times when coincidences are not permitted, or this term basically goes down to zero? It means that obviously at those moments, the photons cannot split here, so they will get bunched both to one detector or the other because the overall probability has to be conserved. So what if we look for the autocorrelation of one detector with itself? So what can cause a click at T and T prime at the same detector? That could happen either if the low energy photon were to get transmitted and detected at T, and then the high energy photon reflected and detected at T prime, Or it could all happen if the high energy photon first got reflected and detected at T, and then the low energy photon transmitted and detected at T prime. Again, if we have to add both these probability amplitudes, and we can see that the autocorrelation function has a very similar expression to the cross correlation, except for the pi phase shift, because the probability has to be conserved. But what is very interesting here is that the same or similar information that we could get from two detectors, we can now get with just one detector and looking at the coincidences of it with itself. And another important thing is that in both these effects, there is an oscillation in the coincidences that corresponds to the frequency difference between these two photons. And narrower the frequency spacing between the photons, the larger is this oscillation periodicity, which means narrower frequency spacings can be resolved even better. And this is a bit counterintuitive, maybe. So it gets easier to resolve smaller frequencies than it is to resolve larger frequency spacings. And this works really well for narrowband photons because they naturally have a large coherence time, and it is important to resolve narrow frequency features in narrowband photons. So when we look at the coincidences of one detector in it with itself, we call this the Ghosh-Mandel effect in time, because Ghosh and Mandel, way back in 1987, did something similar with photons that have a different momentum from each other. So here that is represented by these arrows. And they look for space-correlated coincidence detection. So they look for coincidences between these detectors at position x and x prime. And they basically varied the separation between these detectors as shown in this graph here. And they saw that for some distances between x and x prime, they couldn't see coincidences, whereas some other distances they could see. So they say that in principle, the detection of one photon at one point rules out certain other positions where the other photon can appear. And what we showed with one detector is the time frequency equivalent of this, because in our case, we show that we can bring in photons that have different frequencies, and by performing time correlated coincidence detection, we can see an oscillation in the coincidences, whereas there the measurement is done at a single point in space. So I have introduced this interference experiment between photons that are distinguishable and said that this is very valuable to measure and map narrow frequency features in narrowband photons. But how is this relevant to the work that we do in our group? So to give you some context, in our group, we are interested in atom-photon interactions at the level of a single photon and a single atom. And this when the atom is in free space and not in a cavity. So for this, we take photons from SPDC, we tailor them, we make them narrowband, we make them resonant, and try to interact them with a single trapped rubidium cold atom that is in a dipole trap. Unfortunately, I don't have much time to go into this, but the possibilities of our system is really plenty. With the system, we can study light-matter interactions at the level of single photons and single atoms, and we can study things like stimulated emission, collective effects like super and subradiance, and these kind of studies can be done by using one of the photons as a herald and the other could be sent to the atom. However, we can also study plenty of interesting things by sending both the photons at the atom and creating an interesting love triangle. If both the photons are addressing the same transition in the atom, and if the atom is a two-level system, then it could at most scatter one photon and cannot scatter both at the same time. And in that sense, the atom is highly monogamous, and we can study single photon nonlinearity. However, we can also create circumstances for a more successful love triangle if these photons are addressing different transitions in the atom. And this way, we can study stimulated Raman transitions, for instance, where one photon actually aids the scattering of the other photon by the atom. We can also create the atom in a superposition of scattering either photon and see how existing quantum interference effects are modified by this. So, but for these kind of applications, first of all, we would need photons which are tunable in their frequencies with megahertz precision, because the spacings between the energy levels that we're looking at is in the order of megahertz for cold atoms. After preparing them, we need a method to reliably measure the frequency content of these photons, measure the frequency with megahertz resolution. And unfortunately, there are no spectrometers available with this kind of resolution. We will also need to verify that these photons do not have contamination from other unwanted frequencies, because that would cause a lot of noise. So And this is how the interference experiment that I introduced fits in. We can use this method to measure the frequency content of the photon source and verify its purity. So before I go into the experimental results, I'll just run through the photon source. I don't have much time. I invite you to read this article. But the core of the system is a cavity-enhanced SPDC system. So we have down-conversion crystal inside a CESPDC cavity. And at the output of this, we get narrow-band photon pairs. Both are resonant to the rubidium D1 line. They're both each in a single frequency mode that has a Lorentzian line shape. And we can make them resonant to different transitions in the atom, or we can even tune their frequencies independently such that they can be detuned, or they can be both resonant to the same transition in the atom. So we demonstrate this by looking at by showing single photon spectroscopy. What you're seeing here is the transmission of light through a hot vapor cell. So on top here is a saturated absorption spectroscopy reference. Below here is coherent. The black line corresponds to a coherent laser that is frequency scanned. And as the frequency of this laser is scanned, you can see that it follows a different transmission profile. We then prepare photon signal and idler. So the signal is shown by the red dot, idler by the blue triangles. We prepare them in this experiment with a 250 megahertz frequency difference between them. And then we change both their frequencies and look at the transmission as they correspond to various frequencies. And their transmission basically follows the profile that the laser follows. So this way, we show that we can reliably make them resonant to different transitions or have different detunings. We repeat this with a different spacing, frequency spacing between them, in this case, 170 megahertz. And we again repeat this to show that we can independently tune their frequencies and scan the entire range of the D1 line. So we use this source to prepare photons with different frequency differences between them. And we use the method, the interference experiment that I introduced in the very beginning, to measure the frequency content of these photons. We call this auto-heterodyne characterization in one word for both the non-degenerate Hongo-Mandel and the temporal Ghosh-Mandel effect. So for this experiment, we take the photons from the source. We prepare them with a certain frequency difference between them. We match them in polarization so that when they arrive at the beam splitter, they have the same polarization. We then look for coincidences after the beam splitter. We look for coincidences between detector C and D for the non-degenerate Hongo-Mandel. And we look for coincidences of detector C with itself for the temporal Ghosh-Mandel effect. So first, I present to you the results of the non-degenerate Hongo-Mandel. We prepared the photons with a 250 megahertz frequency difference between them for this experiment. And this corresponds to 4 nanoseconds in oscillations. We're looking for CD coincidences here. And as shown in the theory and in the experimental data, there is a clear oscillation that corresponds to 4 nanoseconds in this coincidences. And at time zero, the coincidences go down to zero with a visibility of 82%. There is a double exponential envelope around this because that is the time equivalent of the Lorentzian line shape and frequency that I told you these photons have. So this basically gives us the coherence time of the photons or the correlation window between them. We then look at the coincidences of detector C with itself for the temporal Ghosh-Mandel effect for the same photons with 250 megahertz, and this is the theory plot. Here at zero time between detections, however, there is a clear maximum for the bunching. So there is a clear peak shown here. This is the experimental results. And also here we can see the oscillations at 4 nanoseconds. But here we do not have experimental data between 0 to 50 nanoseconds, and this is because of the dead time of the detector. The detector, after one detection, shuts off for about 45 to 50 nanoseconds. This shouldn't be a limiting factor, especially if the coherence time of the photons is larger, as the photon bandwidths get narrower, because then this envelope would just extend out for longer in time. We then perform a power spectral density analysis of this data. We take the Fourier transform squared of this, and we can see a clear peak at 250 megahertz. So had we not known what the frequency difference between the photons were, we could first perform this and then see the peak and use this to infer the frequency content. But we get some more important information from this. We see that there are no other peaks at other frequencies here. And this attests to the fact that the photons have only the central modes with the 250 megahertz frequency difference between them. They do not have contamination from other unwanted frequency modes, which is what we want for our experiment. So performing this kind of an analysis can give information on the various possible frequency content of the photons. And in our case, we have a very spectrally frequency-wise pure source. We perform the photons, we prepare the photons with a different frequency difference between them, in this case 165 megahertz, and that corresponds to 6 nanoseconds in oscillation. And we again perform the power spectral density analysis, and we get a peak here at 6 nanoseconds and 165 megahertz. So I'm just in time. I have to wrap up soon. I'd like to summarize. We have shown that with time resolution, even distinguishable photons too interfere in a beam splitter. And this can be seen in the second order correlation function, even with only one detector. With this method, we can have infinite frequency resolution. And with this, we can measure the narrow spectral features from our source, and we have verified that we have a single mode output. The outlook for this, I haven't had time to show this, but we not only get information on the frequency difference axis, but we also get some information in the frequency sum distribution of the photons. We also see that this method is actually sensitive to the phases between the photons. So we are exploring if we can use this for a complete mapping of the joint spectral amplitudes of a two-photon state. And this finds plenty of application in quantum information processing, where photons are the information carriers and the information has to be processed by atoms or ions or NV centers or solid state memory systems that need narrow band photons. So that's this is my group. We're always looking for PhDs and postdocs, so please apply if you're interested. Thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. That's really, really interesting. Thanks for the talk, India. So whilst we're waiting for some questions from the audience, please don't be shy, audience. I'd be really interested to know a bit more about the outlook and maybe other applications of this technique of the non-degenerate home.
Okay. So what we saw is that we can also, I said that we get some information on the frequency sum axis, for instance. So I can show you something about that. This is, for instance, here I have plotted a two-dimensional plot. On the x-axis is the arrival time difference after the beam splitter, and on the vertical axis is the sum, arrival sums. So we see that from this, we can actually get the profile of the pump laser, because the sum of the frequencies of the photons must always add up to the pump frequency. And in this case, we are having a very narrow band pump, which means the frequency of the pump is very, very well defined, which means these photons are highly correlated. But this means that the pump has a very large coherence time. So there's a large discrepancy in this arrival time sums, as you can see here. But it follows the same whatever profile. For example, if the pump has a Gaussian profile, we can infer that line width from this, and from this we can plot the JSA and the JSI, and we can infer to what extent these photons are entangled or correlated with each other. And in this case, we simulate the results for a pump that is more broadband. It has a bandwidth comparable to the photons, and here this is evident from the arrival sum information of the photons. And we can infer the Gaussian pump envelope, and we can see that in this case the photons are lesser entangled as they would be if we had a narrow band pump, for instance.
Great, thank you. And we have a few more questions from the audience. So Alex Jones and Alex Clark are both asking about adding a beam splitter and a detector to one of the channels to get around the dead time problem for the detectors.
Yeah, that's a very good suggestion. Thank you very much. Yeah, that's a very good suggestion. We could have done that. For instance, with the Gauche-Mandel, temporal Gauche-Mandel effect, for instance, we could have just added one more detector, for instance. Yeah. Here we could have beam splitter and a detector, and that could have gotten over the dead time. But I guess the point was to show that with one detector you can get the same information that you can get with two detectors. Mm-hmm. So lesser components.
Yeah, Yeah, definitely. Thanks. Uh-huh. And maybe just one more from Peter Koch and John Rarity that ask mm-hmm. about how infinite or what's the limits of the frequency resolution?
So, very interesting question. It's very counterintuitive or difficult to think about. The thing is, if you think of the smallest possible frequency that you can resolve, that is really infinite. Because basically, if you look at this expression that we have for the if you just look at this expression, really smaller the difference between these frequencies gets, these oscillations would be larger time separations that for which this term would go again to zero and again to zero, right? So smaller the frequency differences, really it becomes much easier to resolve it. So I would say that the smallest frequency that you can resolve is basically like infinite, 1 hertz, less than a hertz, even better, as long as you have the you can keep time averaging, you can keep accumulating data for so much time. But then I think the larger, the more significant limit is in the upper limit of this range that you can resolve. If you had this again, it depends on the resolution of the detectors that are available today. I think today we can go down to tens to hundreds of picoseconds. More than 10, less than 100 picoseconds is the range today. So something like a few hundreds of gigahertz of frequency difference between these photons mm-hmm. can be reliably resolved by this method.
Great, thanks so much. That was a really interesting talk. Thanks for
thank you very much. Lydia.